Okay, so we're going to be looking at today is your second part of the Baroque period, and I'm sorry this is late. I recorded it and posted it once, but apparently it didn't work right. So we're trying it again, part two. All right. So we start off with Louis the 14th. He really becomes the vision of the Baroque period. And the power and spectacle that he presents is very important. He had these very elaborate rooms, but he was also the master of the idea of absolutist power. This is the neoclassical time. So Louis the 14th, he had a lot of art kind of supporting his reign and giving into almost like a propaganda. And he exerted absolutist control in cultural affairs. So he controlled the academies, the state-sponsored agencies that trained artists and performers. And he also kind of dictated standards of tastes. Under Louis XIV, academics governed all of the arts, including theater, dance, opera, painting, and sculpture. Although they brought order to the patronage of the art, the academies also imposed rules that stifled a lot of the artists' innovations. They depended heavily on the revival of classic Greek and Roman forms, hence the name neoclassical. When you think of Louis XIV, you think of Versailles. The Palace of Versailles was both balanced and restrained in its design, yet lavish in its scale and decoration. It was really a compromise between the excesses of the Baroque period and the neoclassical kind of structure and rules. So, Louis' minister once advised him that, with the exception of brilliant military action, nothing speaks so eloquently of the grandeur and cleverness of princes as buildings. The palace complex at Versailles expanded to accommodate Louis XIV's changing vision of what is an absolutist court. The house was originally a retreat from the bustle of the Paris court. However, soon Louis demanded the influential French nobility come to live with him at Versailles, where he could control their influence. Now, this, as you can see, is a pretty plain facade, very structured garden, but inside very elaborate decorations. The neoclassical of style is evident in the restraint of the three levels of the palace building. The palace ground arcade, the main level with its shallow columned porticos, and the upper level topped with elaborate statues and balustrades. Simplicity and charm of the Mansart facade is dwarfed somewhat by the palace's wings, which stretch 2,000 feet from end to end. Mansart's greatest stroke of genius, though, was the famed, and this is a picture of it, the famed Hall of Mirrors. Here, overlooking the garden, Mansart built a row of floor-length windows, and on the facing wall, matching windows of glass. So you had windows here, and then glass over here, mirrored glass. With its grand length, brilliant light, and gilded decorations, it really embodies the grandeur of the Louis the 14th's court. Theater and dance. He was a very generous, Louis XIV was a very generous patron of the arts and dance, but he also had a almost dictator-like control over the academies. And really, you couldn't dance anything that wasn't approved by the academies. The academies decreed that plays performed by Paris's emerging professional theater must be divided into five acts and obey the unities of time and place and provide an uplifting moral. So they were extreme in dictation of form, of length, of even up to the style of the moral tale. So two of the great artists of the time was Racine, who followed the path of his older competitor and presented classical themes in a conscious, artificial, academic style. Racine's tragedies were strictly governed by the neoclassical unity, concentrating the plot on a single main action and locale. The characters spoke in an exalted rhyme, as the Academy dictated, and his themes were usually drawn from ancient Greek. Despite the academic restrictions, Racine's tragedies presented a compelling drama of characters driven by their own desires and follies. He was often criticized for being too realistic. The neoclassical tragedy of Corneille and Racine have remained the standard repertoire of French theater until today. However, the most famous and perhaps the most beloved of the time was Jean-Baptiste Poliquin, also known as Molière, who used wit to attack hypocrisy, the main vice of French society. Molière was a playwright, actor, and even a part owner of a theater company, but he had gained the favor of Louis XIV, who granted his company a theater inside the Louvre in Paris. Several Molière's masterpieces were first performed at court. Among his greatest comedies were Tartuffe, the story of a religious hypocrite, Les Bourges Gentilhommes, which mocked the French war as social climbers. His plays were exceptional in their relentless wit and consistent moral attitude, and showed a careful observation of social manners of the time. And I put in here a trailer about a movie of Molière's life.
With an unusual request.
J'ai écrit une pièce. Et pour m'attirer ses grâces.
Provides him with an unbelievable opportunity.
Monsieur Molière transmettra tout le contenu de ses connaissances dans le domaine des arts de la scène et du spectacle. Signé.
But of course, there's a catch.
J'ai gardé le secret absolu auprès de Madame Jourdain.
Madame Jourdain?
Votre nom, monsieur?
Tartuffe. Installez confortablement, monsieur Tartuffe.
Je vous dis qu'il m'a fait des avances, monsieur.
Êtes-vous sûr? A tale of lust, love, and the comic adventures that would inspire a legend.
Je ne fais rien. C'est comme ça que vous vous ferez connaître.
Parlez-moi en français, mais plutôt parlez-moi dans la langue de Molière.
Molière.
And in fact, people have said that. Because, oops, sorry. Molière became the playwright of the time. And his plays were so distinct because they were done in rhyming couplets. And incredibly funny for their time, with an absolute sardonic wit. They were funny to the thinking man, and Tartuffe was one of the greatest. I do recommend you look at Tartuffe. All right, so in the theater and dance, the French courts. Most influential figure was Jean-Baptiste Lully, who was the innovator in both French opera and French court ballet. Lully was a dancer in the Ballet du Cœur and gave a young Louis XIV his name, the Sun King. Louis danced the role of the god Apollo wearing sun ray headdress and a solar emblem on his chest. The Italian-born Lully headed to the Royal Court's Academy of Music and from this position ruled as a virtual dictator over French music, opera, and dance. Under his regime, French dance was professionalized and the Ballet du Cœur evolved into a flexible and unified art form. Court ballets usually feature an interlude and entrees during the performance of a comedy or an opera. Lully composed 20 operas that remained the standard for more than a century. He also developed a national style in opera that suited the French desire for pomp and spectacular show. However, the playwright Molière incorporated ballet directly in the plot of his comedies, collaborating with the royal dance master and choreographer, Charles-Louis Beauchamp. Traditionally, court dancers were aristocratic amateurs. To train professional dancers, Lully established a dance school at the academy, where Beauchamp developed a formalized foot and leg positions, still used in ballet today. Beauchamp's positions were designed to present the dancer's movements effectively to an audience seated before a stage rather than around the dancers in a palace room or courtyard. Among the French court's other advances were the first appearance of professional women dancers in ballet and the publication of a manual of choreography that standardized dance notation. In the painting, perhaps one of the court's most beloved painters was Peter Paul Rubens. He was originally from Flanders, which is now Belgium. Rubens excelled at themes of nobility, nobility favored the themes. Seeing such as his rape of the daughters of Leucippus, I think it's Leucippus, not positive on that, permitted the patrons to identify the figures of mythological and romantic prowess. Here you have the gods Castor and Pollux visiting Earth to take human wives. There's their human wives. As you can see, there's a lot of emphasis on movement. We see tons of movement here. Hands out, stretched. The sisters are resisting their violent kidnapping, as you can tell by their twists in their bodies, and they're reaching for help. One sister's being awkwardly lifted, but inevitably towards heaven, caused to move upward and give motion to the picture. You can see how they're both being pulled this way. And even though the horse allows you to kind of put your hand, your eyes down and around, you can see this movement that's going this way. Rubens' second wife, Helena, inspired one of his most famous pieces, The Garden of Love, in which Rubens welcomes his young bride into the gallant conversation and flirtation of the group at center. The second group of bona fides occupy the porch at the rear, and a statue of Venus, right here, at the upper right, blesses the scene with the elixir of love. And you can see all the little cupids, the cherubims. So you have another court up here. You've got Venus, and then you've got his introduction of his bride. One of the other painters of the time who became the essence of Baroque neoclassicism, which was the opposite of Rubens' very dynamic painting, his very energetic and movement-oriented painting, Nicolas Poussin's exemplary subjects of St. John at Patmos, which was the author of the Book of Revelations, who's pictured among the monumental ruins of what looks like Greek civilization. So we got a little bit of a time issue here. In the painting, Poussin strikes the perfect balance between the order of nature and reason's endeavor of humanity. Like the light of divine reason, sunlight falls impassionately across the figure of John, an uneven ground of nature and broken pedestals and columns of a civilization in destruction. In the painting, the exiled St. John stoically records Revelation's fiery vision. Poussin may have felt a connection with St. John because of his own self-imposed exile to Rome. You can see all these broken columns. Not much movement in this painting compared to that last one. Which brings us to religion. The Protestant Baroque. Protestant religions in Europe mostly included the northern area, the Dutch Republic, the Germans, and so on. This is the Spanish Netherlands. Here, Luxembourg. Here we have France. But this was mostly where our Protestants of northern Germany and the Netherlands. The Germans were politically divided at the time, suffering from the strife and devastation of the 30-Year War, which is why there's so many countries divided compared to what we see today. Most German nobles imitated the French styles. From such circumstances emerged the most famous of the Baroque composers of music, Johann Sebastian Bach, who is perhaps considered the most prolific of music geniuses. In contrast to Germany, the Netherlands had an upsurge of national feeling and cultural vitality fueled by commerce. They were a heavily colonized and heavy trade-oriented, and political independence. They fought a long war for independence from Spain. The war left the Dutch suspicious of extravagant absolutist sports and the Counter-Reformation Catholic Church. So this area was kind of suspicious of kings and suspicious of the rise, the reemergence of the Catholic Church. Their Calvinist churches were bare, but they didn't decorate their townhouses and public halls with grand paintings. They did decorate. And their most famous painter was Rembrandt van Rijn, which we know as Rembrandt. So first, let's look at Bach. Bach's music typically exhibit the essential features of the Baroque concert music. One was an elaborate counterpoint, which is the combination of two or more melodies of equal importance. The term counterpoint is sometimes used as a synonym for polyphony. That's when we have different voices singing at the same time. The second feature is the basso continuo, which is the prominent bass line that harmonically supports the polyphonic line. So I'm going to play one for you. The Brandenburg Concertos features both counterpoint and basso continuo. So here's one, Brandenburg Concerto number 2, which we have an ensemble of recorder, oboe, trumpet, and violin, which emerge in this polyphonic conversation. The continuo provides a harmonic ground. Like his predecessor and mentor, Vivaldi, by employing the recurring ritornello to punctuate the ensemble's melodic exploration. So listen if you can hear these two. hear the polyphony of the different pieces playing at the same time. They almost feel like they're talking to each other. You have this beat that's kind of holding them together and making, you know, the basso continuo. You can kind of hear that harmonic ground that's holding all of those together. Well, Bach was appointed music director and composer of St. Thomas Choir School in Leipzig, which was one of the big academies, during which he composed music for the four major churches and served as the church organist at St. Thomas. Instructed the choirs, taught at the school, and undertook additional compositions for German nobles. But he still had time saved to give music lessons to his children and hold concerts at his home. For each week's religious service at St. Thomas, Bach wrote a cantata, which is a choral work that provides the principal music for Lutheran worship. The text of the cantata was chosen for a particular Sunday or a feast day and celebrated the yearly cycle of the church calendar. The cantata contained recitative or aria-like forms and served as a kind of sacred opera for the Lutherans. Bach frequently closed his cantatas with a familiar Lutheran hymn that the congregation might join in singing. So for example, we have cantata 8, number 80, which was composed for the feast day of the Reformation and ended with four parts saying of Martin Luther's famous hymn, "A mighty fortress is our God." Bach had 300 cantatas in all, and note to complete five cycles of the liturgical year, the year of the church. So let me play with this for you. And I'm going to kind of go quickly to the end after we hear a little bit of the beginning. Again, you can hear the polyphony, and I want to bring it closer to the end so you can hear at the end a little bit more. So you can kind of get here. You can kind of hear that that chorus at the end that sings the hymn. You can hear the amens and stuff. So, you know, he kind of ends with that familiar hymn. So while Bach did not impose any operas, he was the author of a monumental masterpiece of storytelling of St. Matthew's Passion. It was used to retell the last days of Christ's life and show the exhibit of the emotional ranges from despair at the crucifixion to the triumphant joy of the resurrection. St. Matthew's Passion is a gigantic work, calling for two orchestras, two choruses, organs, and solo voices. And I have just a little bit of it for you. As you can see here, it's a pretty large group of people. Also quite long, at over 2 hours. I just want to show you. Even though it's not an opera, there's these solos within it that goes over. The story of Christ's death and resurrection. And then uses these different voices. I have another one we'll skip ahead to. The oboe. And then goes to the next section. And now listen to this solo. The death of Christ section, you can see how somber, and then this is the joyous resurrection. Here are the music changes in emotion. And you can just hear how it's sung in a different passion. So again, very long. I'm not going to give you the whole thing and totally bore you to death. But if you do have an interest in music, listen to the whole Passion. It's quite lovely. You can go right to our regular PowerPoint and just click on this and it'll open up that page and you can listen to the whole thing. It is in German, but listen to the emotion, not the words. You can tell what's happening by just the emotion of the singers and the music. All right, so... as early as 1600, the European composers had devised a system of musical keys to replace the traditional modes used by the ancient medieval musicians. And these are the keys that we're familiar with today. Seven intervals between the eight notes of an octave scale are arranged according to specific formula a whole in half tones. A musical key's principal pitch, called the tonic, serves as the tonal center to the entire composition. For example, a melody written in the key of C usually begins and ends on the tonal C. Baroque composers also learned to transpose the melody from one key to another without altering the tune, a technique called modulation. Bach composed a set of musical exercises called the well-tempered clavier to prove that a clavier, which is a stringed musical keyboard, could be tuned to accommodate all 24 major and minor keys. Tempered refers to tuning of the instrument, not a mood. The sense of order and possibility for infinite variation of this module system appealed to the Baroque taste for mathematical complexity. Bach's composition for the organ and other keyboard instruments exploited fully the major and minor key system, often in musical forms of prelude and fugue. The prelude, also called the Triccata, is a free form designed to show off the keyboard player's virtuoso ability. The fugue is the polyphonetic musical form in which a theme is developed through the elaborate counterpoint. The fugue typically begins with the theme or subject, which is answered by another melodic line, the counter subject. The voices continue to build, repeating the subject or counter subject and exploring contrapuntal variations, especially on the organ, which allowed three voices, both hands and foot pedals. Bach's compositions highlighted the virtuoso of composer and player and appealed to the Baroque love of intricacy and embellishment. And I'm just going to play a little bit of the well-tempered clavier. Just going to listen to a little bit of it. So you can hear this is in C. Then we're going to switch to C minor in a few minutes. You can see down here is all the key numbers to help you along. So here's C minor. So you can hear that difference in tone. So again, this is nearly 2 hours long, but if you want to explore and you know more about music than I do, which I'll be honest with you, I know about music in terms of the composers. Don't know much about music in terms of reading it, but it has the different keys down on the bottom, so you can actually scroll through and look at the different key changes. All right. Down to a little bit more of my wheelhouse painting. Rembrandt and the Dutch Baroque paintings. Because the Calvinist Dutch did not have much decorations in their church, artwork was mostly sold in the free market to decorate people's homes and public houses. So we suddenly had a change from the church being the museum and warehouse of beautiful paintings, which would normally have a religious bent to them, to homes and hotels and restaurants and things like that, public houses, places where people gather in public, suddenly had paintings, including museums starting up. So many of the papers did not find much wealth in this market. For example, the first great Dutch Baroque painter, Frans Hals, ended his career in poverty. However, this did open the market to more female painters. Judith Leister was the first woman admitted to the Painters Guild in her city. Rachel Ruske excelled in the popular genre of... Sorry. Hello?
Lydia.
Yes.
It's Nancy. Couple things. So I've got your
Nance, can I call you back? I'm recording a video.
I need, text me with my first number, please.
All right, I will text you that. I'm sorry about this.
Okay. No problem. Okay, bye.
All right, bye-bye. Sorry about that. I will have to get this over soon, but we'll get this going. The popular genre at the time was flower and fruit painting. So as you can see here, this is one of the types. Perhaps the most famous, most remarkable painter of the Dutch genre was Johannes Vermeer, who, that shouldn't be steel, sorry. Loved, esteem for the Dutch interior was apparent in his most philosophical work, The Allegory of Painting, and the intricate fabric of allegory in visual patterns in this work. The painter's model's costume as Cleo, the music history, and the curtain is drawn back on the left, and the painter's fanciful costumes enhance the painting's theatrical air. A cool light suffuses the entire scene. With this picture, Vermeer seems to claim for himself, his modest art, the respect accorded to tragedy and music, symbolized by the mask and cheap music on the table. Although Vermeer was unknown in his day, he's now regarded as the master of light and color. Rembrandt van Rijswijk enjoyed the prodigiously successful career in Amsterdam. Rembrandt was perhaps the most famous of the painters of his age. He came from the Italian school of painting. He gathered his religious and historical themes from from the Italian school, and from the Dutch school, his scenes of ordinary life and studies of human character. The height of Rembrandt's popularity is best represented by the sortie of Captain Banning's Coke Company of the Civil Guard. Pictures also known as the Night's Watch. Upon cleaning it, the painting was discovered to be in the daylight. I'm going to show you that in a second. This one is another Rembrandt painting. This is Christ Healing the Sick, which was one of his etchings. The lines are scratched on wax-covered metal plate, and the plate is treated with acid that etches the exposed metal. Then prints are taken from the plate. So this is actually a plate that you use in printing. Rembrandt was also famous for his self-portraits, more than 60 of them. They depict three eras of his life. Early in his career, he was presented as a worldly sophisticate dressed in fashionable attire. His second stage of self-portraits promote his international renown, in which he depicts himself as a Hellenistic painter, Apelles. Finally, late in his life, Rembrandt painted himself in humbler clothes, you can see here especially. During this time spanning the late Renaissance and Baroque, eras, Europe witnessed an intellectual movement that altered human history and perhaps more than any other force created the modern world. This movement was the scientific revolution. The historical process by which modern science became the authoritative method for investigating and describing the world. The modern scientific method is on two principles: the empirical observation of nature as a means for writing at the scientific truth, and the verification of proposed truth through experiment and mathematical calculation. So observation, verification. The new scientists employed new instruments in scientific study, such as the telescope, and then new forms of mathematics to make accurate and verifiable scientific predictions. So I have a nice little cartoon here of Kepler's uphill battle. So you see the orbit of the planet is elliptical. What's an orbit? What's a planet? What's elliptical? Having trouble explaining things when people have no idea what you're talking about. Nicholas Copernicus. The scientific revolution began in earnest with the publication of On the Revolutions of the Heavenly Body by Copernicus. The Polish astronomer proposed a heliocentric theory of the universe. In other words, the planets revolve around the sun. The sun is the center of what we now know as our galaxy, but at that time they considered the universe. And that's the theory in which the sun stands statuary at the universe's center, with the planets, including Earth, revolving around it. Even though Copernicus was in error about how the planets orbited the sun, he thought they orbited in a perfect circle like this. His calculations of planetary motions were better than the previous Ptolemy astronomical system, where the Earth was the center of things. So Copernicus' revolutionary theory spread quietly among the findings, inspiring obscure German mathematician Johannes Kepler to resolve laws. Kepler was the first to deposit that the planets are arranged within the framework of concentric geometric solids. This did not precisely account for the planetary motions. I don't know why I have will there. However, it will be realized that the planets moved in elliptical order. Sorry about that. Not circles. Kepler realized that the planets moved in elliptical orbits, not circles. In 1609, he published New Astronomy, which was the positive laws of planetary motion that finally overturned the classical Earth-based model. Empiricism. Philosopher John Locke's question was bold. He said, "Let us then suppose the mind to be, as we say, white paper, void of all characters, without any ideas. How comes it to be furnished?" The answer that he came up with was bolder still. To this answer, from experience. No ideas except from experience. That is the philosophical motto of empiricism. And Locke's essay concerning human understanding was the first important statement of empiricism in the 16th century. Locke argued that the human mind began as a tabula rasa, a blank slate. The mind was furnished with ideas from two sources of experience: the observation of external objects, sensation, and of its own inner workings, reflection. No ideas were innate. This seemed to be a direct attack on Descartes for his philosophical rationalism, where Descartes relied on clear and distinct ideas that were intuitively true. Locked it out in the ideas were determined by the mind's contact with experience. This opposition of Cartesian rationalism and the Lockean empiricism is still inhabits scientific thought today. Tabula rasa and our joke is, I always thought that meant the time after students returned from spring break. Hume and Kant. The Scottish philosopher David Hume took empiricist skepticism a step further in his study of causation. In Hume's view, if one pool ball strikes another, the movement seems to cause the motion of the second. But how could we be certain that this succession of events would be repeated the next time? Hume argued that either reason nor experience were able to establish a causal connection based on inductive observation alone. That is, our imagination could actually create a belief in causality. Might still exist in the world, but our ideas about causal sequence were inductive connections of our mind. The German philosopher Immanuel Kant spoke of awakening from this dogmatic slumber to challenge empiricism in his Critique of Pure Reason. Kant would insist that the mind actively shapes experience rather than merely registers impressions from the outside world. In the 20th century, philosophy would provide empiricist skepticism to challenge all medical physical thinking, including Kant's. So again, this is a cartoon for that. The holy grail of nationalized epistemology. It looks, at last I found it purely discovered what justification. It looks kind of like, All right, what's it look like? It looks kind of like your mom. Awesome. It's a your mom joke. Tools of the new science, induction. Copernicus and Kepler employed scientific deduction, the discovery of the truth through logical calculation. An important example of this was the early physician William Harvey's theory of blood circulation, which he discovered through mathematical calculation without actually observing the circulatory system directly, because at the time it was illegal to open up a human body and look at it. However, a powerful tool of the new science was induction, reasoning from particulars of fact and systematic observation of the world. One of the pioneers of scientific observation was Danish astronomer Tycho Brahe, who observed the appearance of a new star. Actually, it was a supernova, which cast doubt on the ancient notion that the heavens never changed. This won Brahe great patronage in Denmark and Prague, allowing him to build observatories and make precise catalog of the movement of extraterrestrial bodies. And this is Copernicus's greatest find. Galileo Galilei, perhaps one of the greatest heroes of scientific observation, was the Italian astronomer, businessman, and mathematician Galileo used the newly invented telescope to revolutionize astronomy. He observed moons around Jupiter, spots on the sun, and craters on the moon, all contradictions to conventional wisdom. Galileo debunked traditional astronomy in his dialogue on the two chief systems of the world. The church responded, threatening the scientist with trial and torture. So Galileo recanted his belief that the sun is the center of the world and moves not, that the earth is not the center of the world and moves. Galileo was forced into retirement and house arrest. However, he continued his studies using both deduction and experimentation and wrote his most important scientific work, Discourses on Two Sciences, on the physics of moving bodies. In his work, Galileo completely overturned the Aristotelian physics by treating the forces of motion as your mathematical quantities. Descartes. The troubles between Galileo and the Catholic Church caused the French mathematician René Descartes to postpone publication of his own study of Copernicus. Had already angered church authorities with his provocative discourse on methods, a philosophical manifesto of the new science and practice to his discoveries in mathematics and science. In the Discourse on Method, Descartes describes the painful uncertainty and skepticism of his youth. Descartes wonders why all knowledge cannot resemble those long chains of reason, quiet, simple, and easy, that geometry used in its proofs. Descartes had arrived at the principle of his scientific method. Cogito ergo sum, I think, therefore I am. From this principle, he could deduce other perfectly clear and distinct ideas, including the existence of God and the certainty of his own mathematical proposition. So our modern day version, I have a website, therefore I am. Isaac Newton. Descartes' confidence in the rational mind was confirmed by the age's most important discovery, Newton's universal law of gravitation. In his Principia Mathematica, the Englishman Isaac Newton synthesized the discoveries of Galileo and other scientists into a unified theory. Newton asserted that all bodies, large and small, earthly and heavenly, natural and mechanical, were subject to the same gravitational force. He showed how gravity's pull could be quantified precisely. The success and promise of new science attracted government sponsorship. The Royal Society of England and the Paris Academy of Sciences sponsored scientific activity and published scientific papers. The government suddenly replaced the church in sponsoring knowledge. And this is an important movement, because suddenly knowledge was free. The church had a very kind of tight hold on it and wouldn't publish, allow anything published that might change their church guidelines or views. So as science started moving away from the supernatural, government took over the sponsorship. And by the way, Newton never discovered by being hit by an apple. He probably saw some of it, and that helped him figure out the means of gravity's pull. Charles I of England. King Charles I hoped to unify his rule over England, Scotland, and Ireland and make his monarchy the match of France or Spain. He acquired rich collections apart from Italy and bought to his country, the prodigious painter Anthony van Dyck. In less than a decade, Van Dyck had more than 40 royal portraits of Charles and 30 of his queen, but Charles failed to easily unify his nation. The Scots rebelled against religious uniformity, and in 1692, civil war erupted between the chiefly Puritan Parliament and the Royalists. In 1649, Parliamentarians beheaded the king, and the crown wasn't reinstated until 1660. The achievement of the British culture played a part in the age's stress and tension. Native talents such as John Milton and Christopher Wren melded English traditions with continental style and tastes. John Donne. Some critics rank John Donne close to Shakespeare in the riches of his poetic achievement. Donne's intellectual lifestyle and complexity of emotion place in a group called metaphysical poets. Donne was a deeply religious man who applied his complex imagery to both sacred and secular themes. His famous poem, which we're going to look at in a few minutes, Death Be Not Proud, is an affirmation of the triumph that salvation wins over death. Those love poems characterized by jarring associations and comparison. In one poem, Donne erotically compares love or sex with the blending of the lover's blood in the belly of a flea. So we'll start with Death Be Not Proud. Death be not proud, though some have called thee mighty and dreadful, for thou art not so. For those whom thou thinkest thou dost overthrow, die not. Poor death, nor canst thou kill me. From rest and sleep, which but thy pictures be, much pleasure then from thee much more must flow, and soonest our best men with thee do go, rest of their bones and souls' delivery. Thou art slave to fate, chance, kings, and desperate men, and doth with poison, war, and sickness dwell, and popular charms can make us sleep as well, and better than thy stroke. Why swellest thou then? One short sleep past, we wake eternally, and death shall be no more. Death, thou shalt die. So in this poem, Donne is addressing death, which he personifies. And he said, you shouldn't be such a proud being, because you ain't as big as you think you are. He says, some have called thee mighty and dreadful, but you're not that way. And you think you overthrow people, but yet they don't actually die. And you can't kill me because I'm saved. And he's comparing death to just a sleep and a rest. And he's saying that, we'll be delivered from that. And he's saying that death is slave to fate, chance, kings, and desperate men. Meaning that death can be caused by fate, or you can die from chance, or you can die because a king orders you to war, or you can die because a thief steals and kills you. And he's saying that poison, war, and sickness are part of death. But he also says that death is just a sleep. So poppy, opium, and charms, meaning sleeping potions, can make us sleep as well. You go into a coma and sleep as if you were in death. So you should not be so proud of yourself, because we can make things like you. We can artificially make death. But the truth of the matter is that death is just a sleep. And when we wake up, we go to heaven and death shall be no more. So this is a very religious poem, but yet also kind of the tone is rather angry at death, saying that, I'm not scared of you, buddy. I'm believing God. One of our other main poets of this time was John Milton, and he's perhaps the greatest of the English poets. And he created a masterpiece called Paradise Lost, which is an epic poem that recounts the original origins of Christianity. Of Adam and Eve. The fall of Adam and Eve and their expulsion from the Garden of Eden. Milton's underworld in his Christian saga with allusions to classical mythology. Milton also created the first anti-hero by making Satan a more attractive character than the Christian heroes of Christ and Adam. He kind of likes Satan in this piece. This is also the first time you wrote a book-length poem, and the poem is written in iambic pentameter, or free verse. Milton also did most of it while he was blind, so he wouldn't write it down. Instead, he would dictate it to people, and his dictation was better than mine. But he would dictate it to everyone that came to visit him. Christopher Wren was a professor of astronomy and the founding member of London's Royal Society. Wren's architectural hobby became his profession when he was appointed the Royal Surveyor of Works and asked to modernize English architecture. The Great Fire of 1666 destroyed 3/4 of London, including the original Cathedral of St. Paul, and that gave Wren an unprecedented opportunity to leave his artistic signature on the entire city. Wren's largest assignments was the construction of the new version of St. Paul's, and his design was to mediate between patrons' various traditional tastes and his own preference for the prodigious neoclassical style of Versailles. The neoclassical double portico is flanked by towers, that use the principles of both Gothic and Baroque styles. Above the portico is the towering dome, indebted to Brunelleschi and Michelangelo, but somewhat obscured by the imposing facade. The interior of St. Paul's is only barely related to the exterior. Wren, often less architect than engineer, placed little value on this connection. The architect aimed for a central unity of a Renaissance design, while his clerical patrons insisted on a traditional Gothic floor plan. The interior's most distinctive feature is the domed crossing. The dome rests on 8 arches, 4 on the side opening to the nave, choir, and transept, and 4 on the corners closed off by apse-like niches. In the overall design, Wren achieved a unique synthesis of Gothic, Renaissance, and Baroque styles and created London's most admired architectural landmark. So the music. Henry Purcell wrote music of all sorts, but he excelled in music for England's theater of the Restoration period. Purcell wrote one great opera, which was Dido and Aeneas, which was based on a Roman book by the Aeneid. So Purcell's aria conveyed Dido's complex state with compact eloquence. Purcell's achievement was overshadowed by the popularity of the Italian-style opera in England and the career of George Frederick Handel. We're going to listen to a little bit of Dido and Aeneas. Again, this is kind of long, but you get the impression. Here's one of the arias. And you can kind of hear there that musical tone that he uses and his own use of polyphony. Handel. All right, although German by birth, Handel lived half his life in England and was honored as the nation's leading composer of the Baroque period. He was named musical director of the Royal Academy of Music, which exploited the English fashion for Italian opera. But Handel's academy had failed within a decade of its founding, causing the debt-ridden composer to suffer a stroke and a midlife crisis. Handel rescued his career by turning to oratorios, a narrative choral work containing the musical elements of an opera, but without action, scenery, or costumes. Handel was working on a tight budget, and this was a perfect compromise for him. And of course, his most famous oratorio was Messiah, which you probably have heard at least once. Messiah recounts Jesus' birth, his death, and resurrection, and the promised redemption to all humanity. The religious feeling of grandeur in the story was matched by Handel's music. The famous Hallelujah chorus combined intricate counterpoint and imitation with a similar chordal passages of dignified majesty. The chorus builds up to a jubilant finale with a unison of so magnificent that the British king stood up on first hearing it. And of course, I'm going to play a little bit, but you guys have heard this. And this is the end, the Hallelujah chorus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
So you can hear I use these different tonal changes and some repetition, but yet builds this movement of glory in this piece. John Locke. By 1688, the English political compromise had unraveled. King James II, which was an absolutist king that believed in the absolute monarchy, and a Catholic, had become so enraged his parliamentary opponents that the monarchy left London in fear of his life. The Parliament had quickly installed a new king and queen from the Protestant Netherlands. Britain traded an absolutist king for a constitutionally limited monarchy with virtually no bloodshed. Just 2 years later, Locke published a philosophical justification of the Glorious Revolution. Locke's two treatises on government argued that governments originated in a voluntary association and consent of humans acting in their rational self-interests. This is very different than what was published previously, which promoted the idea of a god creating a monarchy and appointing the monarchy by virtue of their birth. So like his predecessor, Thomas Hobbes, Locke predicted that human society had arisen from a state of nature, whereas Hobbes asserted humans were naturally greedy and violent, Locke claimed they were reasonable and cooperative. Hobbes' pessimistic view convinced him only an absolute monarch, a Leviathan, could impose social order. Locke's more optimistic position located the beginning of civil order in a social contract, an agreement in which humans traded the absolute freedom of the state of nature for the limited freedoms of civil society. By passing a government with some powers of legislation enforcement, Locke theorized humans secured their most cherished freedoms. Locke's social contract became the foundation of classical liberalism, a political doctrine that prizes individual rights and freedoms and strives for a constitutional government that secures individual autonomy. The idea of absolutism, that one person can rightly claim all the power, violates Locke's liberal balance between an individual's right and social order. From the social contract, citizens retained unalienable rights, to quote the American Declaration of Independence, that no government should ever violate. Theorizing that citizens might justly overthrow it to run a government to establish a state that respected individual rights, Locke was writing a license for political revolution. Now, let me kind of break this down a little bit. Locke was making an important change. Before him, many of the philosophers like Hobbes believed in the idea of an absolute monarch, but a benevolent monarch, a benevolent king, was the best form of government. And there was this idea that government, that a king should run the government because a king was appointed by God by virtue of birth. What Locke is saying is that no, we as humans have reason. And we group together, we no longer live like animals. We give up that absolute freedom of the natural state to join together in a collective. And when we do that, we allow limits on our freedom. But those limits must be agreed upon by the group, not imposed on them by an absolute monarch, but rather an approved agreement of the whole. So as you can see from some of these points, this became the obsession and really the inspiration for the American Revolution. They agreed with Locke that humans could rule themselves, that we should give up some of our absolute freedom for limits of civil society, but that it only works if we're an educated and consenting adults. So it's interesting to see this birth. And we say liberalism, we don't mean liberal like left-leaning, but rather liberal like someone who believes in this idea of democracy. All right, so that's it for that. Sorry this came a little late. I'm going to give you guys an extra week to get everything done. So things won't be due Monday. They'll be due the following Monday. Because I'm sorry Blackboard didn't pop this up like they should have.